Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Yeah. All right. So I'm really excited to introduce our speakers today. We have four researchers who've come all the way from Lübeck, Germany, and they seem to be awake at the moment. So that's good. So our speakers today are Stefan and Ankit, and we have their colleagues also in the room, Roman and Gunther. And each of them has a little bit different background in either electrical engineering or biomedical engineering. And they've come together to build some really interesting hardware systems that look at making really precise and accurate measurements of electrical signals on the body. So they're going to talk today about one of their systems that looks at biological impedance, as well as some of the other research that they've done in their lab. So I'll let you go ahead and get started. Thanks a lot.
Yes, hello everybody. Thank you, Gabe, for the nice introduction. I'm going to speak about a high-accuracy bioimpedance measurement system for time-resolved measurements, and I also will give an outlook about the campus we have at Lübeck and other ongoing research project in our lab. And let me start with what is brand new in Lübeck. We have this Biomed Tech campus. It's called Wissenschaftscampus, so it's something of research campus we have in Lübeck. And the marketing argument is a strong alliance between science and industry, and a long-term cooperation becomes institutionalized. What does it mean? It means we have research on campus. Seven members of the Biomedtech campus are, for example, the University of Lübeck, the Lübeck University of Applied Science. There's the two universities we have in Lübeck, which sharing one big campus. And we have the research center in Borstel. We have the Fraunhofer Mewis Image Reconstruction Group. We have a few companies like Euromoon and Fraunhofer EMB and also Müller-Wiebel, which work all on this campus and have all researchers on this campus in Lübeck. And we have for this Biomedtech campus, there are some services which are so-called co-opted campus partners. For example, the MediCert company, the FHL research company. Then is Olympus, Winter and Ebeck is part of this partners, as well as on campus, the Technology Center Lübeck, which is mainly facilities, the Chamber of Industry and Commerce, and also the University Clinics of Lübeck. Through all this cooperation partners, we have teaching synergies through coordinated course structures on the biomedtech. It's all connected by biomedical engineering, and you may know biomedical engineering is in fact electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, and medicine. We also have medicine courses there, so you can also study human medicine in Lübeck, and medical engineering science, and so on and so forth. A few clusters we have at the Biomedtech campus are the clinic cell technology, the medical software and system engineering group, and the group we all come from is the Tandem. This is a center of excellence for technology and engineering in medicine. And we also have the Smart City Research Group, a research center, and the Software Systems Engineering Group. All it's coordinated in a way as a commercialization is over the MediCert company, which is a cooperation of the both universities. And the share is about 75% university and 25% University of Applied Science. And it's some kind of a contact point to industry over this company. And they're also doing the other back office for the Center of Excellence for Technology and Engineering and Medicine. and they also do some service agency stuff like conference measurement management, travel management, etc. And to focus on biomedical engineering on Tandem, Tandem is the bundle of expertise and know-how in the field of medical engineering from the both universities, and we have about 20 institutions involved, the 20 different institutes from medical engineering over physics to electronics. And where we directly come from all these different spots here, is the LME, which is the Laboratory for Medical Electronics. And we are focusing on non-invasive measurements of cardiovascular parameters. In fact, you see a proband or patient on the left side, and then you have easy acquirable signals like ECG, like the photoplethysmogram, or also the impedance signal where we will focus today. And it's all about the heart, the center, and the different modalities which you can acquire to estimate different parameters of the body and the state of health. Okay, let's start now with the talk I promised. Let me first introduce a bit what is electrical impedance, because I was told that the audience is mainly computer science, so I want to start a bit with the basic of what is electrical impedance. Electrical impedance, is what you may know from school, is the opposition which a current gets when it's traversed to a resistance. And this is the normal DC definition. The AC definition is pretty much the same. You have a complex impedance Z, which is defined by the division of the complex voltage and the complex current. And you may see on the figure how a typical measurement circuit looks like. You have an excitation source, you have a resistor, you put a voltage or a current to the resistor, and either current or voltage can be measured. And when you do this, not for a single frequency or for DC, you only do it over a complete spectrum, then it's called impedance spectroscopy. And when you switch from electrical impedance to bioimpedance, you can think about that bioimpedance is just the electrical impedance of living tissue. And it's proved to be a vital tool in life science and biomedical engineering, because it can tell you a lot of information about the structure and the composition of the tissues you are investigating. And what is well known is maybe the body composition estimation when you have a weight scale, or there's also blood flow estimations and a cardiac output estimations possible based on impedance measurements. And the best thing about it, it's non-invasive, and it has no known hazards as long as you follow the rules of the IEC 60601 in terms of you limit the maximum current you apply. And therefore, it has a high clinical acceptation. So where does the electrical impedance come from? The electrical impedance comes from basically from the cells. You can see here an equivalent circuit. It does not have an... can finger point, yes. So basically you see here the cell, or a single cell, a human cell, and the equivalent circuit, and you have the cell membrane, which behaves pretty much like a lossy capacitor. You have a capacitor and a resistor shunting in parallel. Then you have the inner part of the cell, which is basically a resistor, and then you have another cell membrane. And when you go from one cell to a bunch of cells, you would also have some extra cell liquid, which is also assumed to be resistive. Of course, this is a pretty basic equivalent circuit. But in the frequency range from about 10 kilohertz to 400 kilohertz, this is pretty good fitting, which is also the range where you get the most information about the cell composition or the tissue composition. And this is called beta dispersion, this range. But when you want to measure bioimpedance, you have the problem that you somehow get access to the body. And you have to have an interface between the ion conduction inside the body and the electron conduction outside the body. For that, you need electrodes. And electrodes create, in connection with the body, is a so-called electrode skin impedance. And the electrode skin impedance pretty much behaves also like the tissue has the same equivalent circuit or in comparable equivalent circuit. You have CP and RP, and then you have the series resistance RS, which representing different effects when you have the electrodes attached. So you have the skin layers, and you have the electrode layers, and you have the Helmholtz Doppel layer in between. And therefore, you also have a voltage because you have a developing half cell potential. And the big problem with the electrode skin impedance is that it's variable, it is comparable big, and it changes when you with movement, so it's not constant. And typical value for that are, for example, at 20 ohm at about 300 kilohertz with good electrodes, but it can also be 2 kilo ohm at low frequencies when you have a bad electrode, so the loose-fitting electrodes or electrodes which used to be wet but then become dry, for example. So you have the basic measurement problem when you have electrodes. So we have the impedance we want to measure here, ZT for that tissue. Then you have the two electrode impedances. And when you think about what you now have is when I told you that ZE1 and ZE2 are much bigger than ZT, you make a big measurement error when you just have a two-point measurement and you want to estimate the tissue impedance. And to get around this, there's a standard method, is a so-called four-electrode setup. In the four-electrode setup, you don't have only two electrodes, you have four electrodes. And in the inner electrode, you measure the voltage, and the outer electrodes you use to push a current through the tissue, and then you can measure the voltage drop above the tissue or across the tissue. And with that, you can pretty good estimate or pretty good measure the tissue impedance you're interested in. When you think about a possible measurement setup, you will come to an equivalent circuit which more or less look like this. You have on the top left, you have the current source, which is modeled as a real current source, so it's an idle current source with two parasitic components, a resistor and a capacitor, which limits the output impedance of this current source. Then you see ZE1, which represent one electrode, the current electrode. Then you see when you go from top to bottom, you have the tissue impedance, which is here named Z. Then you have another electrode where it comes out and the current out. And then you have a shunt resistor for measuring the current. So when you look at this slide, it's exactly, so we have the current source, the two electrodes, and what is extra is now the shunt resistor. And from the shunt resistor, you have just a measurement block which measures the voltage across the shunt resistor. When you know the shunt resistor in size and value, you can then calculate the current. And for the voltage measurement here, in this case, is a programmable gain amplifier. You have the other two electrodes for the voltage measurement. And here, what is crucial is you have here also parasitics, R and C, which are mainly composed of the cables you use. So you have the electrodes, you have the measurement equipment, but you need a cable in between. And normally you want to use a shielded cable, so a shielded cable as a capacity, so you add a capacity. Additionally, you have the PGA. The PGA is also not idle and will also have some input capacities and some input resistances. And you may see it on a first glance, you will then get a problem here. You build a voltage divider between this point and this point. And as lower this impedance becomes, as more voltage drop you will have on the electrodes. And this leads to a measurement error. And the measurement error is a function of the electrode impedance and of the input capacity, mainly of the PGA. So also the cable impedance is important. And when you think about, you have about 30 picofarad cable impedances, and you can make the with a bit mass and a bit analyzing of the circuits, you can formulate this equation, which gives you the measured impedance Zm as a function of the real impedance Z multiplied with the two error terms, which represent the voltage error. So the error you make is the PGAs, voltage PGAs, and the current error you make here because you have an error current also here, which flows into the FPGA. And then you can, when you just put some numbers for ZEs in, and you, when you assume that all ZEs are the same and all ZPs are 30 picofarad, which is pretty realistic for cables, cable lengths shorter than 2 meters, you end up with a lot of formulas, and you see on the left a lot of values, and you see on the left side, you see that, for example, for 50 ohm electrode impedance, you have a theoretic overall error, which is in magnitude less than 0.01%, in phase less than 1 degree. When you increase the electrode impedance, the important is that at 500 kilohertz. the important thing is when you now increase the ZE, for example, to 2 kilo ohms, then you have a magnitude error of 1.73%, 3.37% and 0.19 degree. You see actually the phase error becomes smaller, because this is when you go through it, you see there seem to be some kind of an optimal point in between. But only for the phase, not for the magnitude. So it's kind of a trade-off. At the end up, what you want is you want to have low electrode impedances. Then you have the best chance to have accurate values. Another thing which is also important with bioimpedance measurements is not all this theoretic setup. You have also problems, for example, when you have a clock jitter on your measurement equipment. So when you think about, you measure here, after this PGA, you measure current signal as a voltage, and here you measure the voltage signal as a voltage with an ADC. Yes?
I don't know if you try shield drivers to better...
We do. With shield drivers, you can reduce it around a factor of 10. At least the cable capacities. And then another problem you have is then the jitter. And the jitter can, with a bit formulation, you can estimate that a jitter must be smaller than 19.4 picoseconds when you have an ADC with 14-bit resolution. And when the jitter is bigger, then the error you make because of the jittering around the sample point. So when here's the sample point, the idle sample point, and jitter around, then you can make an error in the range of 1 LSB of the ADC, so you have to be smaller than 19.4 picoseconds. Another crucial point with that is also the output impedance of the current source, because when you go in frequency higher, then the output impedance of the current source drops, and the currents you drive through the objects become smaller, which is, from the measurement accuracy, a smaller problem because you measure the current. But you need to have a current source which maintain a suitable high current also at high frequencies. And what you see here is a study we made in 2012, and a study in 2014, which is at the moment ongoing, where we compare different commonly used current sources. And you see that when you're starting at 100 kilohertz, and you see a decrease in the behavior of the current sources. You have a pretty flat behavior before, and then it starts decreasing, which is some kind of the turning point where bioimpedance measurements become more crucial. So from the terms of the current source and also from the voltage measurement, because all the capacities in the system become starting then becoming dominant or more dominant. So we can conclude that bioimpedance spectroscopy is aimed in a frequency range to 10 to 400 kilohertz. The tissue impedance is much smaller than the ISRA, therefore you need a 4-electrode setup. And what I also told you is that there's a medical standard for which limits the current, the maximum current you apply to a patient, which is the RMS value of about 141 microamp at 1 kilohertz, which can be increased to up to 10 milliamp at 100 kilohertz. And this basically limits the signal-to-noise ratio you can achieve while you're doing bioimpedance measurements. With increased frequency, the stray capacities become more dominant, and they prevent basically the accurate phase measurements, but also the amplitude measurements or the magnitude measurements. And also jitter could have an impact. When you think about, you have multi-channel bioimpedance measurements, they have to be pretty good synchronized, that you have the same phase, not to make a big error. And to maintain a suitable high accuracy, the current source must also be must also have a high output impedance, and the voltmeter must maintain also a high common mode rejection ratio. This is one point I didn't show before, but I can explain it here. When you look at this slide, it's basically the same. You have here the current goes through the object, and here you need to have a high common mode rejection ratio, because you have a common mode voltage at this point, which is given by the shunt resistor and additionally the electrode impedance. And when the electrode impedance increases, then you have a common mode error. This is basically the idea how to set up, how to measure a complete impedance spectra. So when you look at the top left, you have the DAC. Then you have a voltage to current converter, which is normally a voltage controlled current source. Then you have the impedance under test you want to measure. In this figure, the electrodes are neglected. And you have the current shunt to measure the current. After the PGAs, you digitize the voltage and the current signal. Then you do an FFT. Then you have the spectrum of the voltage, the spectrum of the current. And by a simple division, you get then the impedance spectrum. But to acquire a complete impedance spectrum, you need to have to sample multiple points. For example, when you're thinking about a sinusoidal excitation, then you have one frequency, there's next frequency, and so on and so forth. But this will take a lot of time. You just take one frequency, then you configure your system, then you have a transient phenomenon. And another idea is then you can overlay phase-optimize different sinusoidals. But then you have also the problem that the maximum RMS current is limited. And the third option would be you can think about a complex waveform, like a triangle or rectangular. But when you remember your signals and system class, and you remember that you have a decay for higher frequencies. So, and the last thing, which is more or less pretty obvious, is you can use a chirp excitation. So you have a sinusoidal signal which increase in frequency over time. And this is, in the easiest case, in the case we are using it, this is a linear chirp. And the linear chirp starts at a pretty low frequency and over time increases the frequency. The equation is shown above. So you can see here that the current frequency is linear increasing over time. And the really nice property of a chirp is the spectrum is pretty constant in the excitation, in the range of interest. So you can tweak a bit the start and stop frequencies, and then you can adjust the stop spectrum in the range you wanted. And the chirp we have chosen here has the energy concentration between 12 and 400 kilohertz, and I think it's about 99% of the energy are concentrated in this particular spectrum. Good. So now we have the idea. We had a principal measurement circuit, and this is how a possible signal system could look like. This was our first demonstration board. You can see the block diagram here with an FPGA on the left side. You have the signal generation with a direct digital synthesis. You have inside you have an FFT and averaging block, and you have a downsampling block, and you have control logic inside the FPGA. Externally, you have the DAC, which makes from bits an analog signal. Then you amplify the analog signal, and then you have the voltage-controlled current source, VCCS, and then you drive current through the electrodes through the impedance you want to measure. On the other side, the current come in is measured over the shunt and then digitized with an ADC. And the voltage here across the tissue is measured over the electrodes on a PGA, and is then also digitized with an ADC. The firmware buildup in the first step looked pretty much like that. So you have inside the FPGA, you have a soft core microcontroller, which is programmed in C. Then you have different interface modules for the DAC, for the PGA, and for the ADC, which just directly interface with the external components, which is, I think I said it, in VHDL. Then you have a FIFO memory, and then you have a USB transfer to the PC. And on the PC, we had a MATLAB, we have a C interface, which handles USB communication, and a MATLAB interface for all display and high-level control. This firmware is then was then a bit optimized in terms of, we still have the microcontroller, which works as a state machine for all the different modules. We have the DDS and DAC interface. We have the PGA interface, so you can, from the PC, you can send commands to the FPGA, and with these commands, you can set a different gain in the PGAs. You can control the sampling frequencies of the ADC. You can control the actual signal amplitude, and so on and so forth. We have a test data module, which just produces test data to the PC that you can test the communication. We have an FFT module, which directly makes an FFT transformation on the hardware. And we have the ADC module, we have also the possibility to send ADC data directly to the PC for debug reasons, and you see right directly the DAC signal. What is also new here is the AFE block, which is communication for an analog front end. I show you in a minute. And all the communication is then handled here by a multiplexing and packet building block, which basically packs all the data in a block before transmitting it to the PC. This is the first hardware, first PCB of the hardware. You can see on the right side here, G, you see the voltage interface. So you have B and C connectors, and then you can directly put the cables. Here are the screen drivers here and here for the voltage screen, and you can see then a bit analog filter circuits and the PGAs, and D is then the ADC. And from the ADC, it goes then in A, which is the FPGA. And here's the current source and where you put the current electrodes. And here is the DAC. And then you have a bit of USB interface. You have an USB interface, obviously, a few LEDs for debugging purposes, and a small power supply for the board. So what we did with this board was we did some measurements on the electrode skin impedance. For this measurement, we took commercially available carbon rubber electrodes with a size about 40 millimeters, say 45 millimeters. And we glue this, or we fixated this on the lower forearm in a distance of 2 centimeters each. And then we could basically measure the impedance between this point and this point with a 4-electrode setup. And with a 2-electrode setup, we can measure then 2 electrode skin impedances. And the other way around. So when you put current from 1 to 4, and you measure the voltage from 2 to 3, then you can measure the tissue impedance, which is between these 2 points, right? And when you do a 2-electrode setup between 2 and 3, you measure the tissue impedance and you measure 2-electrode impedances. And when you want to calculate 1 ISI, so take the average, and then you say the total impedance minus the tissue impedance over 2, and then you have the average electrode skin impedance. Yes?
Looks like those electrodes have 2 wires coming out of them.
But it's the same.
What are the 2 wires?
Actually, Gunther, why we had 2 wires? I think it's because of the of the 4
cables.
Yeah, when you have the 4 electrodes, when you measure on 2 electrodes, when you measure the 2-electrode setup, you need 4 cables.
So they're the same.
Yeah, they're the same. They're short circuit.
Yeah, okay.
And with the study, we made a bit. Yes?
Yeah, I wonder how you calibrated it. You either built a phantom, or is there a commercially available device that's the gold standard?
The calibration is basically done on resistors. So you have resistors, and you know they have zero phase. And then you can calibrate the magnitude.
But you can
could build a phantom like you showed in your early slide.
The problem with the phantom is you only get capacitors with a tolerance of 1%. When you have really a lot of money, you can maybe 0.1%, but then you don't get the values you need. So basically, normally impedance measurements are calibrated just with resistors. Then you know it's a zero phase. And when you just calibrate the phase is linear. The phase shift is just time.
But there are devices to measure capacitors and then, right?
Yes, but then you would calibrate the system with another system. And then you don't have any gain from that. So when you calibrate the system with exactly known resistors, then it's fine. But we also did studies, and in the papers there are a few measurements I think published where we calibrate this against a commercially available system, as with the Phantom. But for the calibration for these measurements, we did it only with resistors. And the ISI you can see here from left to right, also A and B. Is a study as its magnitude and phase of the ISI with dry electrodes. So the electrodes were just dry and put on the patient on the subject, and then the measurements are taken after 5, 8, 11, 30, and 30 minutes, and 2.5 and 3.5 hours. And what you can see is that, as expected, the ISI drops over time. And you have a big, comparably big rubber electrode on the skin. And what we assume is they just have some sweat water under it, and therefore the ISI decreases because the skin is then moistened. In C, you see the same setup with pre-moistened electrodes. So they were pre-moistened with sodium chloride, 0.9%, so the standard what you get in a pharmacy. And what you can see is that the ISI change then is pretty small. And you can see actually it's increasing the ISI over time, so it's a dry up process. But what you can see is that the ISI is much, much lower. And then we have a boundary of about 110 ohm, where before we had up to 600 ohm. And on the right side, you see the same measurements with pre-gelled electrodes. So that commercially available pre-gelled electrode you put on the skin. And then you see that the impedance of the pre-gelled electrodes is much lower. So this is some kind of the optimal way you can do. Then we also did a study on what is with the current density. As what you read in literature is always that electrodes have a current density dependent behavior. But what we found out is with an excitation current of 125 microamp to 5 milliamps, there is no visible decay in no visible change in the current density dependence, at least with these electrodes. And after that, we did a study on 15 different subjects where we measured the electrode skin impedance with pre-moistened skin after 5 minutes after application. And what you can see here pretty good is that the ISI is totally variable. So it's about almost 50% from 70 to 110 ohm around at low frequencies, and at high frequencies it maintains this broad span. But what we can learn from that is that even for a broad group of subjects, and I think they were ranging from 16 to 36 or something like that, 63, you can see that you have an average ISI which is below 200 ohms, and which is good. When you remember the slides before, then the ISI is highly the error is highly dependent on the ISI. So what can be learned is that for a fast for a good and reliable access, you need a low ISI, and this you can achieve with pre-moistening or pre-gelling of the electrodes. And even with pre-moistened electrodes, the ISI variance was bigger than 50% in our study, but it stays always below 120 ohms. When you even at lower frequencies, when you think about a classical ECG electrodes, they will always have a better, not always, but when you glue them properly, they will have also impedances which are below that. So from a theoretic point of view, we can achieve pretty good measurements, so with 0.1% in magnitude and below 1 degree of phase. And the current density obviously does not show an effect, at least in the current range we use for bioimpedance measurements. And what we found out here is, what is not shown in the pictures before is that the tissue impedance you saw had a variance over time. And this variance looked pretty much like this. So it starts at a top point, then it decays, and you have some notch or something like that, and then it goes up and down. And when you compare this to measurements of the pulse wave or of the photoplethysmogram, what you see on a finger, it looked pretty much the same. And when we looked a bit through literature, then we found out that it was already published, I think in 78. And it's called impedance cardiography. And the basic idea behind it is that you measure the impedance from the neck to the belly, and then you see it gets this curve. And then you assume that the blood is increasing and decreasing during the heart cycle. And with a basic formula, then you can estimate based on this impedance shape and on the values, you can estimate the cardiac output of the heart. And from that point, we decide this is interesting and maybe we should spend some more work on that. And for that purpose, we thought about adding more electronics to the device, and this is the moment Ankit will take over.
This is the moment I come into the picture. So after this, we already had an impedance meter, and we came up with this idea that maybe this could be used to find the stroke volume or the cardiac output of the heart. So we developed a system by combining the impedance meter with all the known modalities present till now. So it consisted of ECG module. We had 4 channels for PPG because we wanted to see the pulse in different parts of the body because they vary with the morphology. So you have a different PPG on a small artery and you have a different PPG on a bigger artery. So we had 4 modules for PPG. And then at that time we had another concept of getting the signals from inside the ear, which is the auditory canal. So we try to use the normal headphones to get the pressure signal inside the ears, which also vary because of the blood being circulated near the arteries or the auditory canal of the ear. And we left one for general purpose, so we could add something else in the later on if we find something important. All these parts were connected to the ADS1298, which was from Texas Instrument. It was an 8-bit, it had 8 ADCs inside it, so we could convert all the signals at the same time. So all the signals had the same time reference. And everything was connected to the cardiometry module, which is just the impedance meter only. And the whole hardware was controlled by the FPGA. And the data was transmitted to the PC and was further analyzed in the MATLAB. So this is how the new hardware looked like. It was a PCB which was around in dimensions 135 mm into 145 mm and had more than 700 components. And as you can see, the assembly of the PCB, the green part is the analog part, which contained all the ECG, PPG circuits. And the blue was the digital part, which was originally from the impedance meter, which Stefan just showed. And then we had a power supply for different parts of the PCB. And all the connectors are shown in the red. So on the right-hand side, the 4 BNC connectors are for the impedance measurement and 3 new BNC connectors for ECG. So this is how the setup looked like for the research. We had a subject, which was a healthy subject, and we connected him like this. So we had 2 blue electrodes, which were the current electrodes, and 2 red electrodes for voltage electrode for thorax impedance. And then we had 2 ECG electrodes, and we put PPG on the index fingers as well as near the ear where the headphones were placed so that we can have a reference that the signal being shown in the headphone is how much similar to the signal being acquired by PPG. So this is how all the signals look like when we acquired. On the first, you have a, we just gave a rectangular pulse, so we can see the time, how the time is happening. And then we have different signals coming out. So the first signal is the impedance signal, which Stefan showed in a bigger way, but it's here, it's a bit small. And the next two signals are the PPG signals, which were acquired from the fingers. Then we had this headphone signals. And then again, two PPG signal. And in the last phase, you can see the ECG signals. So all these signals are time referenced. All are simultaneously taken and could be further used for analysis. And this is was how the originally the signal looked like for impedance measurement. And we excited the patient with a chirp signal instead of a single frequency. But here we just show, so the frequency of the chirp was varying from 12 to 350 kilohertz and 512 kilohertz, okay. And so the, as you can see, there's a change in the impedance also. So we can find the pulse present in the face of the impedance signal, and this was very interesting, and I think it was never reported before. But still, we are looking forward, like how the frequency and the change in the frequency plays role in the change in the impedance.
This is actually a little different. Right? This is instead of the impedance across the thorax.
Yeah, this is not impedance. Yeah, this is on the forearm. Sorry, this is was on the forearm, not across the thorax. But probably we will get the same kind of effect over the thorax also.
See.
You can see the change in the face. The system is like, it has a very good resolution. And after collecting all this data, the main point was to use these existing modalities to find something new, which could not be found by normal ECG and PPG or the information they lack. So we did some really mathematics or MATLAB in it. And first thing we calculated was to try to estimate the stroke volume and cardiac output. And I will tell you about the results. Then next thing we did was heart rate variability, which is very important parameter, and sports and everything. But normally ECG is only used for heart rate variability. So we tried to compare heart rate variability with impedance as well as a PPG signal, because all were taken at the same time. Third thing we do was called PAT and PWV. This is another new thing, which is called pulse arrival time and pulse wave velocity. Right now, there's a lot of research going on in this field, and it's a prognostic marker for cardiac disorders, if someone has an idea. And then we also calculated the number of respirations from some of the modalities we already took. So this was how the flow of the software flow of the implementation of software was. So we imported the signal from the BMS system, then we denoised it and removed the baseline wandering. And then we did some signal processing, and we calculated peaks and valleys on different physiological signals. These peaks were stored, and then all other parameters were calculated by using different signals for different modalities. And then we displayed it and stored it for further use. So for denoising and baseline removing, I used wavelet. And one of the use of the wavelet was to calculate the respiration rate also, because the electrodes which were near the heart or something always had this baseline wandering because of the movement of the chest expansion. So in wavelet, you can easily remove this into different signals. And like you can see on the right hand side, the first figure shows a PPG signal which has a lot of baseline wandering, and you can just remove the baseline wandering, and you can use the removed signal just to find out the peaks will give you the respiration, amount of respiration happening in the body. And these are some of the results we got from all the three subjects, which we tested with all the measurements we had. And I would just like to point out on stroke volume and cardiac output, which was the main aim for doing this research, but the results are not that good. So they are a bit out of the range. This could be the one reason behind this could be because the physical model behind for calculating the cardiac output and the stroke volume from impedance meter or the impedance measurement lacks certain things. So it has so many constants like hematocritic value, height, and weight, which also play a very important role in the calculation. So this was one of the reasons, like for subject three, the output was cardiac output was 10.2 liters. This is not possible. This is something wrong over here. And we calculated PAT values and PW values, which were all in the range for a healthy subject. There was no problem in it, even the number of respirations. And heart rate variability by different modalities, like for ECG and PPG, it is shown, and they are quite similar. So there is no difference if you use ECG or PPG or impedance, you will get the same result for heart rate variability. Yep.
Say the gold standard to compare this to, that you know now it's out of bounds?
So gold standard we use was the standard, like we know the standard values, like there are so many papers being published which has this PAT values and PWV values according to different subjects of different health or something. No, we didn't compare it with some instrument. We just compared the physiological values given in different journals or something.
To get Texas' point, this was a proof of concept. We measure the impedance and we take a published formula for estimating the cardiac output, and it's black magic. Yeah? So there's so many parameters in it, you can tweak pretty much everything, and at least from this basic parameters, and we don't have an invasive gold standard method to test this against.
Because
just a proof of concept.
For stroke volume and cardiac output, there are three gold standards. One is thermodilution method, other one is ultrasound, and one is Pickle method. All three are invasive. You have to get the subject into a cath lab and monitor it. So it cannot be done real time. So that's why it is one of the most important research also.
Well, that would be a goal, right?
This could be a goal also in the future. And so then we came up with the idea, it's not an idea, so we just wanted to improve our system. So we came up with the new bioimpedance measurement system, in which we just had new hardware development and enhanced some parts out of it. So now we have two different PCBs, one containing the impedance meter, which contains the FPGA, and the other is the daughter board, which contains all the analog circuits. Like it has headphone jacks as well as heart sound jacks now we introduce into it. So before we just had two headphones in the ear, now we had to measure the heart sound also on the chest, and we had three ECG electrodes, and I think three PPG circuits now instead of four. And this has a better current source. Stefan didn't spend too much time on the current source, but now it has AD8130 improved current source, so it was just made much more easier and looking much more cool. Okay, so this was how the BMS looked like, and from now on, Stefan would again take it.
Yes, also, a bit to make the point is, what I have the feeling, which was not really transported during the presentation, is we made an awesome accurately measuring device. So Ankit showed on the slides, we can measure phases of 0.01 degree, at least not absolute, but relative phase changes. So what we could show is that we can measure on the lower forearm in the setup we showed, we measured an impedance variation, which was plus minus 50 milliohm. And we have a phase resolution which is 0.01 degree. We could see the difference. And we can measure this in a frequency range between 12 and basically we can measure up to 512 kilohertz with the chirp, which is at the moment implemented, whereby at higher frequencies the signal energy goes so down that the signals don't look that good. So we only show to 390 kilohertz. But to that we could measure pretty accurately. And you can see here the newest generation of the impedance measurement device, which is, before we always named it impedance meter, and this is really the bioimpedance measurement system, which is here what you may remember, recall from the slide, which in black and white where it shows this looks pretty much the same. The difference is it has a much bigger FPGA, a much higher improved firmware, the current source is improved, and or the accuracy is improved. And then we have here the two future interface ports, and with this interface ports you can connect different analog front ends. So at the moment what Ankit says is we had this analog front end, but it's possible to simply connect everything to that. It's an SPI interface which is implemented, and it's an FPGA, so you can think about arbitrary interfaces you can implement and connect to the impedance measurement and synchronize. And this is a crucial point. We can measure the impedance and we can synchronize this with PPG, we can synchronize this with ECG and with this headphone signals, which I will introduce in a minute. And what we also did is we had also a pressure sensor, which we had connected before. Then you can measure blood pressure, for example, also with this system. So what we did is we made this device and we verified it against. So I can give you a paper reference where we explain the calibration in detail. The system is accurate in the range of 12 to 510 kilo. Works in the range of 12 to 510 kilohertz with a given chirp. It's possible to go also down with the frequency to, let's say, 1 kilohertz. And you can also go up to maybe 600 or 700 kilohertz, but then you have the problems that the stray capacities become dominant and also that the cover mode rejection ratio is not that high enough to compensate the error. The possible excitation currents ranging from about 10 microamp to 5 milliamp, whereby the high accuracy is only possible at 5 milliamp. And the overall uncertainties staying below 1% for the impedance magnitude and below 0.1% per 1 degree for the phase in most measurement ranges, with an effective resolution down to 23 milliohm. This is raw data. So when you think about, as told you that we have about four, I hope I told you that we have about 4,000 impedance spectra we can acquire per second. You can think about when you have some low frequency phenomenon like heartbeat, you can do a lot of averaging and then you can improve the effective resolution by factor of 10, factor of 50, depend on how long you average. And the same is true for the phase. Additionally, we have the possibility to measure, at least in the current setup, one ECG, three PPG signal, which is photoplethysmography, and we have two pressure signals we can acquire, and we have two microphone channels. And the analog, and this analog signals, we are interfaced with this analog front amp, and we can sample then up to 4 kilohertz. And also here, we can then oversample, whereby the analog front amp has 24-bit resolution, so you can pretty good measure. And yes, and we did already a few interesting and promising measurements. We also have made some hard sound measurements, so not only impedance, you can also combine it via the microphone jacks, for example, for measuring hard sounds, and put this in time reference with impedance signal. One thing we did, which was basically my PhD thesis, is electrical impedance tomography. You can think of electrical impedance tomography as a multi-channel bioimpedance measurement. The basic idea of that is that you measure currents and voltages, and you can calculate from that transfer impedances. And based on that, you can estimate the impedance distribution or the conductivity in distribution inside an object. The idea is from Henderson and Webster. And you could saw first images in 1984 in this paper. And as bioimpedance measurements are, it's non-invasive, painless, and it's a fast functional imaging modality. So it's you have real time. So you can have up to 30 frames per second or even more. The drawbacks are it has a poor stability, it has low resolution and last computational effort. And what is available is are machines for showing the ventilation of the lungs. So you can see how the lung is ventilated and which part of the lung have air inside and which are not. And the basic idea of this reconstruction is that if you have a current injection in the object, and then you have the so-called forward and inverse problem. The forward problem is you know the impedance as a conductivity distribution, you know the current injection, and then you can calculate the boundary voltages around the body, for example, when you have it around the chest. The inverse problem is what we have. We have the boundary voltages, we have the current injection, and then we want to calculate from this the electrical conductivity distribution. So, and when you look on this equivalence circuit, or on the schematic block diagram, you see on the left side you have a current source and a lot of voltage measurements around the object, for example, the thorax. And the most easy measurement principle is you have just one current source, you have one voltmeter, and you have a multiplexer which multiplexes in a lot of cables. And based on these measurements, you can then reconstruct images. I will just skip the mathematical formulations because of time reasons and show you how it looks a practical setup. For the practical setup, you need a forward model. So you need a model how the patient or how the object you investigate look like. For example, for a thorax, you could use a CT scan from the thorax to generate this forward model. If you have here the thorax, you have here the two lungs. And then you can somehow build a basic forward model. What we did is we have made a tank study in the first place, and you can see here is a tank. Here are the electrodes around. The tank was filled with salt water. And then we did two measurements. We do an empty measurement on the left side, so an empty tank just was filled with salt water. Then we put two phantoms in. And what you can see after the acquisition of the different measurement data and after the fancy mathematical image reconstruction, you can see you have here an increase in impedance, so a decrease in conductivity here and here. Look a bit like this, our test built up. We have here the EIT system, which is in fact like something like impedance meter and multiplexer. Then we have here a cable adapter with a lot of shield drivers, and then we have here the electrode tank, or the water, the tank with a saline solution. And yeah, the tank with the two phantoms, and here's a close-up of the system with cables. We also did this in a small scale with a small tank phantom, which is from electrical point of view, electrical engineering point of view, pretty nice because it's just wires here in the PCB which are drilled, as a wire drilled wires, and then it's milled around. So you'd use basically a wire in the PCB as electrodes. And one thing I also want to show you, this is a measurement we took from a healthy human subject. And you see here's a breathing cycle. So we took a measurement from the patient, from the subject, and the patient breathe in, breathe out. And what you can see here is that he starts breathing out, and then you see an increase in conductivity, a decrease in conductivity, sorry. And when he breathes out, he breathe in, and then you see it's the opposite. And then you can see here partly, you can see a bit of two lungs, but mainly it's an artifact. But what you can see, there's something visible in breathe out and breathe in. And then it looks, when you take the overall impedance, so you sum up all impedances, then you have something like this. So you breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. It's exactly what you see here. So breathe out, breathe in. Okay, so let me now switch the topic to in-ear pulse wave velocity measurements. This is another thing we did. The basic idea is pulse wave velocity is based on the artery system. When you think about it, you have the heart is contracting. And during the contraction, there is blood flow coming out of the heart. It's going to the aorta and from the aorta to the different parts of the body. And you may know that the aorta is elastic. So the heart pumps, the aorta opens and takes the blood volume, and then the aorta closes, and then the blood is pumped out from the aorta. So the aorta helps the heart to pump the blood through the body, so that you somehow have a constant blood flow over the heart cycle. And the elasticity of the aorta is an important prognostic marker for the age of the vessels. And there's a so-called Mohn-Korteweg equation, which says that the pulse wave velocity is given somehow by the elasticity module. and the arterial wall thickness, the vessel radius, and the blood density. So what you can do then is you can estimate the elasticity of the artery, of the aorta. You can measure by a time difference, by a pulse wave velocity. So you measure, for example, the heart starts pumping blood out, and then you measure, for example, in the ear, how long does it take until the blood reaches the ear. Then you can measure the distance, you can measure the time, then you can calculate how stiff the arteries are. And, yes?
Do you measure the distance? You don't have access to those vessels.
No. It's kind of the problem. When I started as an electrical engineer, I thought, come on, it's, everything is the same. You just take a linear and then you measure from the outside. But we have a physicist in the, no, a physician in our team, and he said, no, it's not that easy because every artery looks a bit different. But the good point is that When you look from here to here, the most dominant part is the aorta. And this is thick, and this goes straight, almost straight. So you make an error, but the error is pretty small. Not pretty small, but it's small enough to have still reasonable values. So, and what we want to do is we want to have exact measurements, we want to have comfortable measurements, and we want continuous measurements. The gold standard is you put a cuff around the arm, and then you basically measure the pulse wave velocity on the morphology of the waveform, because you have an outcoming wave of the pulse wave, and then you have a reflecting wave which is reflected. And then with a bit of mass, you can calculate the difference out of that, and then you can calculate from that with a known model of the arterial system, or with an assumed model of the arterial system, you can calculate the pulse wave velocity. And what we think is, we are much more accurate because we don't measure somewhere here with a reflection and back and forth. What we measure is from here to here, so in the ear, and here where the aorta is. So we have a pretty straight connection, with pretty close connection. And the good thing is we don't have a cuff, and the cuff has pressure, and then you have release the pressure, increase the pressure. You cannot do this often. Because then you just press out water from the tissue. So you don't know this maybe from blood pressure measurements at home. When you do it 10 times, the arm hurts and the measurement change. This problem we don't have. So our idea is we measure this in the ear. And how does it work to measure the pressure in the ear? When you think you have here the inner ear, you have here the eardrum, and here's the auditory canal, and here's the outer ear. We have a pressure sensor, which pretty much looks like a headphone. In fact, we can use a headphone. This is why we have these two headphone channels. And we put the headphone channel in the ear, as a headphone, this sensory in the ear. And then we have a closed cavity here, which is the ear canal. And this pressure inside here is pulsating. You may know this effect when you put your head under the water, when you're on the bathtub, you hear your own pulse. When you lay on the pillow, sometimes you hear your own pulse in the ear. And this was a basic idea. When you can hear it, an earphone can also hear it. And so you put the pressure sensor, which is in fact a headphone, in the ear, and then you can exactly measure the pressure change. So what does it mean? We have a change here. Pressure change, where can the pressure change come from? The pressure change must come from some artery. And it must come from the pulsating in the artery. So in fact, it's blood coming in from the heart. So what we have then is the heart pumps, the blood flows, and then we can measure here the incoming blood. So we have exactly the distance, as it's a time reference. And then we have a system which looks like this for the measurement setup. We had a pressure sensor in the ear. We have the headphones, also not at the same time, after each other. It does not fit both for reference, but we have the headphone for the pressure sensor. Then we had a PPG sensor behind the ear and a PPG sensor inside the ear that we were able to measure, take some measurements to somehow determine which artery is providing the signal, so that you can determine how big the artery is and how long the distance is. And for that, we built this ear mold, which is a custom ear mold for, which is personal ear mold. So you have, it's a lot of work to have this ear mold. This is mainly Gunther's work. And you can see Gunther were able to fit a PPG sensor inside. So there's a photo detector and an LED here. And then there's a tube coming out, and then we have a commercial visual pressure sensor, which can measure a millibar. And then you have here the electrical connection. And the whole the SPI interface, its electrical connection is, who can guess it, to what it was connected, to our impedance meter, so the BMS. And also the headphone signal was also connected, and then we could compare some measurements. Especially for that setup, we also made another device, which is then called iGunther. So Gunther make all the work, so we need the iGunther. And it has an ECG, has a pressure sensor, has a PPG inside, a temperature sensor, which is also included in front, small thing, you cannot see it. Only the two wires for it. And you can measure the core temperature in the ear, or almost the core temperature of the body. And we also had an acceleration sensor, so you can basically see if the subject is standing, is falling, is moving. So basic measurement system. It looked like this, and yeah, we made a small box for it with a battery, and then you can wear it. But also a Bluetooth connection. We also made a software for it, then you can see the measurement in real time. And you can export it also to MATLAB, and then you can also configure the system via the GUI here. And this are basically the signals you get, which is pretty interesting. You have here the ECG, which looks like an ECG from emergency room, yeah, from the TV show. Then you have the pressure on the left ear. Then you have the PPG on the left and the right ear. And then you see here, this is PPG left, right, and this is pressure. And what you can see is that the signals are almost the same, right? So the pressure and the PPG, and PPG measures the volume, have the same morphology, or simple comparable morphology, but they have the same starting point. So therefore, we can be sure that the pressure signal we measure is heartbeat related and is based on the artery volume. And then we had the next step in from iGunther, we come to earGunther. And this is really credit card size or smaller than credit card here. So this is a 9-volt block battery. I'm not sure if it's also available here in the States. Okay. So it's pretty small. And so you can simply mount it behind the ear, at least our idea. And then you can measure over a long period of time. And it's pretty much the same as iGunther, the same functionality, but smaller. And here are some measurements we're going to present in 1 week. Woman is going to present it on a German medical conference. And we have here the ECG, and we have then here the pressure curve measured with a headphone, with a slightly modified headphone. And you have here the PPG. It's a temporalis superficialis. This is the thing here, right? Yeah, it's going in front of the ear. And what you can see is it's, except the dichrotic notch, which is missing here, it's exactly the same signal. And based on this, you can then measure the pulse arrival time, as the time between the ECG peak and then the arrival of the wave in the ear. And with easy mass, you can then calculate from the distance and the subtraction of the pulse arrival time from the pre-ejection interval or period, so the time from the ECGR peak until the heart starts pumping. So can then calculate the pulse wave velocity, and a few measurements we did, having 6.4 meters per second for pulse wave velocity, and this is for males below 30 or around 30, it's totally fine and totally in the range. We also compared it with a few measurements of older people, which increase in pulse wave velocity, which indicates that it's pretty much good working. But to catch the next question about the gold standard verification. We didn't do this so far, but in this case, we're planning to do this soon. So we're able to detect the pulse wave in the ear, and we have a time continuous measurement there. It's comfortably wearable. It's cheap. Basically, it's a headphone, which is slightly modified. Then we have, as what we are not sure is about where the signal genesis is really from. Before we saw this, maybe the tympanic membrane moves a bit. Then in between was it that the auditory canal is pulsating. But the auditory canal is a bony and cartilage structure, so it's unlikely that it's pulsating. And I think the current idea is that it's really the outer part is where the superficialis is, that it's just pulsating. So here's a dragus, and all this is just pulsating because of this pulsation that even the pressure sensor is a bit moved. But this is not clear so far. And the good thing is we are thinking about an enhanced method which we can correct for the pre-injection interval, which is here fixed to 70 milliseconds, so we just assumed. And we have one method in the pipeline which allows us to measure this directly. In an outlook, which we also think about is, so far we just have sensors to the body. So we just measure what the body is producing. Maybe we can enhance this with a few actuators. For example, when you think about a cuff, for example. So one thing is what we have a research project is to knock on arteries. So you have a cuff, and then you knock on the cuff, and then you produce a pressure change, and then you can measure the pressure change. And what you can do is you can do system identification. Now, so you have an artery which is unknown from its behavior. Then you make a pulse, an external pulse, and you can measure the reaction. You can do the system identification of this artery. Yes, this was basically my talk. Thank you for your kind attention, and I'm totally open for questions.
So we can take questions from the audience. So while people think, I'll ask a question. So it looks like you built a lot of really interesting hardware that you can now do some exciting new medical research with.
Yes.
So, you know, where is your interest? Is it just in the hardware? Is it also in kind of the medical science?
Basically, I'm electrical engineer, so I'm interested in hardware. So my part was I built this hardware. I verified the hardware in terms of the electrical signals. And this is where my interface is, and Ankit is biomedical engineer. So he starts from electronics and do all the verification and says, no, this is the wrong artery, it does not say, make sense. No, a vein cannot produce a pulse. So this is all the stuff which comes from Ankit. And so far, we also have this medical clinic in Lübeck, which we can cooperate with to do some clinical trials. But in fact, we're losing manpower. We're lacking manpower, so we are a few people only, and this
it's a time-consuming effect.
Yeah, it's all every kind of thing. So this is one thing.
Do you collaborate a lot with medical partners?
In fact, we have a medical partner in our group, which is also active in the German, what is it?
Conference for...
Yes, the arterial stiffness.
Yeah.
German Society for Arterial Stiffness, whatever. And DGAC, is the abbreviation. And yes, so, but this is it's a collaboration in terms of we have advice from him, we have exchange of thoughts, but not more so far. So we had really at the beginning. Now we have the measurement system, and now we have to go to verify it or to with the gold standard.
Any questions? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Very cool.
Which part?
Just the non-invasive pulse wave analysis.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's very invasive by putting a pressure sensor inside a vein or an artery.
Yeah, is this the gold standard, in fact, yes?
Well, the Eastern medicine, mainly Chinese, have known this for many, many, many years. And Western medicine just hadn't caught on.
In fact, as we have a cooperation with a Chinese university, and then we were saying, yes, we're doing pulse wave analysis. And then the Chinese professor responded, yeah, we do this for 2,000 years about.
Yeah, but it's subjective, though. So you got to get those gray-haired palpation.
Yeah, exactly. And then they put their fingers on, then I think they decide three or four different pulse wave feelings.
Yeah.
But in fact, the morphology changed a lot over the age and over the stiffness. You don't have then the direct carotid notch anymore, then it just is just a big wave, not a big pulse.
Any other questions? All right, let's thank our speaker again.